It was the beginning of the week of Passover, the most sacred week in the Jewish year. Thousands of faithful Jews had gathered in Jerusalem in celebration. Some historians estimate there may have been as many a million or more that had traveled to that holy city. But Jerusalem wasn't just any city. By the first century, Jerusalem had been the center of sacred geography of the Jewish people for more than a millennium. But it was a complex place with very positive as well as painful associations, particularly at the time in the first century when the Gospel of Mark was written. Jerusalem became the capital of ancient Israel in the time of the King David. And under David, Israel experienced the greatest period in its history. It was united under one king. It was relatively large, but more importantly, it finally felt powerful enough to let the people feel safe from their neighbors who kept invading them time and time again. David was a just and righteous king. He became associated with goodness and power and protection and justice. From the perspective of the Jewish people, King David was the ideal shepherd king, the apple of God's eye, maybe even God's son. King David's son, Solomon, built the temple in Jerusalem in the 900s BCE, and it became the sacred center of the Jewish world. It was the navel of the earth, connecting this world to its source of God. Now, of course, they knew that God wasn't only in the temple. God was too big to be contained in a single building, but God was especially present in the temple. To be in the temple was to be in God's presence, and to have access to God's forgiveness mediated through sacrifice. It was the only place of sacrifice, and sacrifice was believed to be the means to forgiveness. To stand in the temple, purified and forgiven, was to stand in the presence of God. And then disaster struck. In 586 BCE, Jerusalem was conquered by the Babylonians. The city and the temple were destroyed, and many of the survivors of the war were taken into exile. It looked like the end for the Jewish people. But fortunately, it was not. After about 50 years in exile, they were permitted to return to their homeland, and they rebuilt the temple, although more modestly. But at least they were home. But things were never the same. Jerusalem was now under foreign rule, and the temple, in addition to being a center of the Jewish people's faith, also was the center of the local foreign government. Life under Roman rule was hard and oppressive for the majority of Jewish people. They experienced political oppression because society was ruled by the few, the elites, the top 1 or 2%. Ordinary people felt they had no voice in shaping their society. They experienced economic exploitation, the way the laws and the social structures and the taxes were set up. A vast percentage of the society's wealth that was generated by the common folk went into the pockets of the wealthy and the powerful. And adding insult to injury, religious language and arguments were used to legitimize the system of oppression. The people were told that the king ruled by divine right. God was on the king's side. The king was, in fact, maybe the son of God. The social order reflected the will of God, and the powers that be were ordained by God. Now, that logic might have made sense when applied to the memories of King David, but it was likely horrifying when used to describe the oppressive Roman rule. Was this really what their God, the God who had made promises to Noah, Abraham, Sarah, Moses, And therefore to them, was this really what God wanted for God's people? Had God brought them out of Egypt, out of exile, for this? Or was there more to come? Which brings us to that spring day in the year 30, when everyone was gathering for the beginning of the week of Passover. There were actually two processions that entered Jerusalem that day. One was the parade that we've been celebrating, a peasant procession. The other, an imperial procession. One might call it a military parade. From the east, Jesus rode a donkey from the Mount of Olives, cheered on by his followers. Jesus was from the peasant village of Nazareth. His message was about the kingdom of God, and his followers came from the peasant class. On the opposite side of the city, Pontius Pilate rode in, the Roman governor of Idumea, Judea, and Samaria. He entered Jerusalem at the head of a column of imperial cavalry and soldiers. Pontius Pilate was in town to supervise the Passover pilgrims. The government was concerned not so much about the religious leaders, but about the instability of the crowds. That's a lot of people, and they can get riled up. Pilate's military procession was a demonstration of both Roman imperial power and Roman imperial theology. And there were likely many, many more people at his parade. Can you imagine the hopes and fears that Jesus inspired in the people that day as he entered the city? He was a teacher, a healer, a prophet, a rabbi, and a challenger of the establishment. But some in the crowd also recognized Jesus as the fulfillment of the hopes for a new king, one who, like King David, would be righteous and powerful and would restore peace and justice to their world. And the Roman soldiers assigned to keep the peace were wondering, how much of a disturbance is this likely to cause? What will we need to do to keep this Passover crowd under control this week? Because you see, the writer of the Gospel of Mark wants us to understand that Jesus isn't simply going to Jerusalem as part of the Jewish religious tradition. This is the climax of Jesus' ministry, because he is going directly to confront the powers of political, economic, and social oppression that occupy their capital city. The center of their government, and the center of their faith. God and politics were inseparably intertwined, and in my humble opinion, I think they still are. Jesus' march on Jerusalem is a provocative act, a challenge to the powers of leadership centered there. And although on that spring day, it wasn't clear exactly who Jesus was, or what his plan for community organizing, activism, or revolution was going to be, it is clear that the people on the margins, the common people, those who were often overlooked and silenced, were much closer to understanding what was going on than those that were the appointed leaders, or the elite, or the people of privilege. Those who were most wounded, most oppressed, most in need of justice, cry out in hope of Jesus' humble entry into the city. Hosanna, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the coming of the kingdom of our ancestor David. Truly, God is still with us. I had very similar feelings of hope yesterday as I watched the coverage of the March for Our Lives. Yesterday was a really, really hard day for those of us in the Pilgrim family and community, and for me as well. There were a lot of emotions, there were a lot of tears. We celebrated the life of Phyllis Bowen, who has been a pillar of our community, but we had a chance to understand the far-reaching impact that her life had. We mourn her loss, and it's an unimaginable hole that can never be filled. But it was so clear yesterday, and as I talked with people, how she lives on in our memories, and more importantly, in our actions. And then in the evening when I got home, watching the powerful speeches and crowds of our young people, talking not just about gun violence, but about fundamental human rights and accountability, modeling inclusivity in a way which many of us have failed to see happen. Not just focusing on the high school shootings in privileged neighborhoods, but embracing people in those urban neighborhoods that perhaps they never would have had a chance to meet had it not been for the most recent tragedy. And not just embracing them, empowering them, giving them the microphone. Our story is their story. Speaking truth to power, using the language that power can understand. We have large numbers. We will not go away. We are young and we will live longer than all of you. We will vote you out. And we have power, financial, celebrity support on our side. These young people are not our future, they are our present. And thank God for that. Amen. Truly, God is still with us. So yesterday was a tough day, but it was also a blessed day, and one in the end gave me a sense of hope. Today, on Palm Sunday, we stand at the beginning of Holy Week, which is a tough week in the lives of Christians, but one that we shouldn't be afraid of because it also ends with enormous hope. So I invite you to enter into this week and not to avoid it. Avoiding it is a perfectly natural reaction when you know that something hard is coming. But if you can, I invite you to avoid that temptation. And I invite you to enter into it because in many ways, the oppressive powers and economic systems that Jesus was challenging still exist today in our world, in our country, even in our local community. And many of us are still fighting them in our own way. So I think there are unique and relevant and timely lessons that we might find in the story of Jesus' final days. We have journeyed to Jerusalem with Jesus through the season of Lent, and now it's time for us to enter the city and struggle with the same questions that those present that spring asked themselves. Two processions entered Jerusalem on that day. Which procession are you in? Which procession do you want to be in? Amen.